You may have heard this one before, and if you have, that's fine, but I'll tell it again. A man who is a bit intoxicated stumbles along a baptism service one Sunday afternoon down by a river. He proceeds to walk down into the water and he stands next to the minister. The minister turns and notices the man and says, "Mister, are you ready to find Jesus?" The man looks back and says, "Yes, preacher, I am." The minister then dumps the man under the water and pulls him right back up. "Have you found Jesus?" the pastor asked. "No, I didn't," said the man. The minister then dumps him under for a bit longer and brings him back up and says, "Now, brother, have you found Jesus?" "No, I didn't, preacher." The pastor, in a bit of disgust, holds the man under for at least 30 seconds this time and brings him back up and says in a harsh tone, "Friend, are you sure you haven't found Jesus yet?" The man wipes his eyes and says to the minister, "Are you sure this is where he fell in?" They got Roger. This morning we find ourselves in the book of Acts, the Acts of the Apostles, as it is properly known. We find ourselves focusing on the topic of baptism because we obviously have some baptisms this morning. Acts 10, 44-48 tells us about the Gentiles receiving the Holy Spirit, and it states, "While Peter was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who heard the word. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter said, 'Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?' So he ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, and then they invited him to stay for several days." We could just say, see, it's important to be baptized. The scripture tells us it's important to receive the Holy Spirit. And we could just stop the sermon right here. We could, but we won't, John Morningstar, in case you are excited. Instead, we need to know the context of these five lines of scripture. They're not just isolated. Previously in Acts 10, we're told that Caesarea is a And there is a man named Cornelius, and he's very important because he's a centurion of the Italian cohort, so he's Roman. Caesarea is a seaport on the eastern coast of the Mediterranean between the ancient cities of Dor and Jaffa. So we have the centurion, but what does that mean? We hear that word a lot in the New Testament. So let's break it down, and we'll go to HarperCollins Bible Dictionary for this. It means that Cornelius is the commander of 100 soldiers in the Roman legion, and the legion consists of 6,000 men. Centurions were prestigious members of a relatively small class of military leaders. They received a substantial pension upon retirement, and they would be one of the most notable people in whatever town they were ruling. So this Cornelius guy is a very important man. He's very important in the established ruling government. He's someone that the disciples should be cautious around. He's someone that the disciples shouldn't even be around, because the disciples would know that centurions were in charge of the soldiers who killed Jesus. So we know that these Roman soldiers who are looking for disciples to be under the command of someone like Cornelius. But we're told in the scripture of Acts 10 that Cornelius is a man who is devout and who believes in God, and so do all the people who live in his household. That would include not only his family, but all servants as well. Cornelius has a vision in which he sees an angel of God coming to him and telling him to send for Simon, who is called Peter. And so Cornelius does just that without questioning. And while these men are journeying to Joppa to find Peter, we're We're told that Peter falls into a trance and he sees a vision. Acts 10, 11 through 16 tells us, he saw the heaven opened and something like a large sheet coming down, being lowered to the ground by its four corners. In it were all kinds of four-footed creatures and reptiles and birds of the air. Then he heard a voice saying, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "By no means, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is profane or unclean." The voice said to him again, a second time, "What God has made clean, you must not call profane. This happened three times, which is a great number for Peter, as we know. And then suddenly the whole thing is lifted up and it is gone. We're told in the scripture that Peter doesn't really know what to make of this. It seems a bit confusing. And while he's trying to figure this all out, the men who were sent by Cornelius appear. And the Spirit tells Peter, "Look, three men are searching for you. Now get up, go down, and go with them without hesitation, for I have sent them to you." Peter and some other believers from Joppa go in with the men, and they see Cornelius, who falls at Peter's feet and begins to worship Peter when he arrives. But Peter tells Cornelius, "Get up, don't worship me, I'm only a mortal. I should not be worshipped." Peter finds that many people have gathered in this home, and he tells them, "You yourselves know that it's unlawful for a Jew to associate with or to visit a Gentile. But God has shown me that I should not call anyone profane or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without objection. Now, may I ask why you sent for me?" Cornelius tells him that 4 days ago at this very hour, at 3 o'clock, I was praying in my house when suddenly a man in dazzling clothes stood before me. He said, "Cornelius, your prayer has been heard and your alms have been remembered before God. Send therefore to Joppa and ask for Simon, who is called Peter. He is staying at the home of Simon, a tanner by the sea. Therefore I sent for you immediately, and you have been kind enough to come. And so now all of us are here in the presence of God, and we want to hear what the Lord has commanded you to say." And then they wait for Peter to speak. I think that would be one of my greatest fears, for me to just show up somewhere and someone says, "We're all waiting to hear what the Lord has told you to say." Oh. An on-the-spot request for a homily. A can-you-give-us-a-sermon-right-now request. How comfortable would you be with that, Reverend Blankey, Reverend Beamer? You were in the grocery store and someone said, "I'd like to hear a word from God." You take a moment. And so Peter probably took a moment. And then he gives this great word on inclusion. He says, "I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him." He goes on to recount the life, baptism, ministry, crucifixion, and resurrection of Jesus the Christ. Peter tells him how he and the other disciples have been commissioned to preach the good news. And that's why Peter has had this vision about inclusion and why he's currently standing in this house with Gentiles. And now is the time in the scripture that we finally get to today's verses. So see, if we only took those five verses, we'd really have no idea what's going on. Peter is still speaking, but the scripture doesn't tell us what he's saying, because for once, what Peter says is not the most important thing that's happening, because what is taking place at that time is the Holy Spirit is falling upon those in the house who have heard Peter testify and proclaim the good news. And we're told that the Jewish Jesus movement people who are with Peter are astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit has been poured out on these Gentiles. But this is what Peter's vision about the animals was all about. The fact that all people belong to God. The fact that human beings have no business making divisions and deciding who or what is profane. After the Holy Spirit falls upon the Gentiles, we're told that they speak in tongues and they extol God. Extol means to praise enthusiastically. So these people are praising God, and Peter is taking all of this in, and he asks a question. Now, it's not clear who he asks it of. Maybe it was the other followers who came with him. Maybe he asked himself. But Peter asks, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" There's no answer in the scripture. No one just responds with, "Oh yeah," or "Oh no." But there doesn't have to be an answer, because there's already been an answer. God, the movement of the Holy Spirit among these people is the answer. So Peter orders that Cornelius and the rest of the household be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. And we're not told about these baptisms in detail, but that's okay. We know that they would have happened right then and right there. Peter wouldn't have waited, because this is an aha moment for the Jesus movement. This is an aha moment for Peter, and he has a lot of them in the New Testament. He would stand there witnessing all of this, witnessing the power of the Holy Spirit, just like it had fallen upon him and the other disciples, and he would know that the next step would be to baptize these believers. Baptism is an initiation rite involving water. The term is from a Greek word that I cannot pronounce, but that Greek word means to immerse in or wash with water. And the First Testament rituals that involve washing with water characterize priestly preparation for offering a sacrifice and are connected with purity in general. Some Jews also apparently perform baptism of proselytes as part of the purification of New Covenant members. In the Second Testament, especially after the death and resurrection of Jesus, we have a lot of baptisms going on. Jesus was baptized, and therefore his followers are also to be baptized for purification reasons and also to signify being new members of the movement. Baptism is also a prophetic call to repentance and forgiveness of sins. We have to remember that Jesus gave the disciples directions on what to do when it came to baptizing people. Jesus is always telling them about baptizing people, but we don't get a lot of info about Jesus actually baptizing people in the Bible. Matthew 28:18-20 reminds us that Jesus said to his disciples, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of age." Just because Jesus wasn't going to be around on the earth with them much longer didn't mean that the disciples should stop following the commandments. We've talked an awful lot about that through Lent and the Easter season. Peter is following Jesus' command when he baptizes Cornelius and the household. It shows that the witness of Jesus still continues in the world. It shows the obedience of Peter as a disciple. In baptism, we're reminded of Jesus' death and resurrection. Christians die with Christ and are buried with him as we go under the water, and as we rise out of the water in purity, we share the new life brought on by his resurrection. We arrive into newness of life, life in Christ that as we come out of this water. It's a covenant between us and God. Through Jesus the Christ, God has declared that death will never have the final word, that the resurrection represents eternal life for us as well. And we declare to God through our baptisms that we know that we are not perfect. We know that we will never be perfect, but we promise to follow the example of the one who has died for us. We will do our best to fill ourselves with love and light and be the hands and feet of Christ in a broken world. God so loved the world. And today, Zach, Abby, JC, and Logan will be baptized into that love, an inclusive love, a love that wraps around every one of us, a love that wraps around those people who we may even think are not worthy, those people who have never confessed a faith in God, because we know that God loves all of God's children, whether we want to admit that love or not. And today, Zach, Abby, JC, and Logan will find newness of life in their relationship with God and also with this congregation. And for that, we give thanks. Thanks be to God.